Good morning and welcome to the Deanery Garden at Canterbury Cathedral on this morning of Friday the 25th of March as we meet for morning prayer. Welcome wherever you are across the world. This is a principal feast of the Church. It's the feast of the Annunciation of our Lord Jesus Christ to the Blessed Virgin Mary, and we keep that as an island of a principal feast in the middle of Lent. So we set aside Lent for today and celebrate the glories of this feast of the Incarnation, in a way, as being an announcement of what will happen on Christmas Day, 9 months later. And the story of that we shall read in our reflection. It's also a day which is a sort of anniversary for all of us in the Garden congregation, because it was exactly 2 years ago today that we began to say morning prayer together in the garden. Since then, we've not missed a day, you and us, and it's been a lovely journey all the way through. So thank you for your massive support as our congregation has grown and grown, and we've made friends with people all over the world in garden congregations since that 25th of March in 2020. And now, having had one anniversary last year, here we are at a second anniversary. So happy birthday, garden congregation, on this morning. We are, of course, continuing our prayers for the people of Ukraine and people in all kinds of dangers through pandemic throughout the world, and those attempting to help them. And as far as the Ukrainians are concerned, give them hospitality and comfort and safety often in other lands. So we remember that in our prayers, but this is also a day of enormous thanksgiving, and it is a beautiful day. When I first looked out of the bedroom window at about 4:45 this morning, there was a thick, I'm going to call it a fog. It was a very thick mist indeed. And then gradually the colour of the mist changed as the sun rose through it, and a multitude of colours appeared with this morning's sunrise. And now later, as the sun has come up onto the tower, then the mist has cleared. There's still a sense of that around, but essentially it's cleared. And we've come here beside this fantastic magnolia. We have several magnolias right across the garden, and they were planted, this one particularly, by the White Thompsons, Ian White Thompson and his wife Wendy White Thompson, whom we knew very well, but he was the dean here for some time earlier in the 20th century, so I think his dates were until 1976. His wife, who was much younger, lived on until very recently, and she loved magnolias. And so this magnolia is a memory of Wendy White Thompson as well, but it couldn't be a better canopy for our celebration of this feast of the Blessed Virgin Mary. So let's begin our prayers with great joy on this morning of blue sky, sunshine, and white magnolia. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. You laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. Blessed are you, sovereign God, creator of heaven and earth. To you be praise and glory forever. As your living word, eternal in heaven, assume the frailty of our mortal flesh. May the light of your love be born in us, to fill our hearts with joy as we sing, Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. And as we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. Our psalm this morning, for the 25th morning of the month, is a part of Psalm 119. I'm reading verses 33 to 40. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I shall keep it to the end. Give me understanding, and I shall keep your law. I shall keep it with my whole heart. Lead me in the path of your commandments, for therein is my delight. Incline my heart to your testimonies, and not to unjust gain. Turn away my eyes, lest they gaze on vanities. Oh, give me life in your ways. Confirm to your servant your promise, which stands for all who fear you. Turn away the reproach which I dread, because your judgments are good. Behold, I long for your commandments. In your righteousness, give me life. There is a lovely verse which is following on in the, not the next section, but the section after that in this psalm, which we could also have read this morning. But verse 54, your statutes have been like songs to me in the house of my pilgrimage. It's a lovely thing, the law of the Lord, and it's reaching out across all creation like songs to me in the house of my pilgrimage. Perhaps we'll come back to that musical illustration a bit later on in our reflection. But for the moment, let's read the lesson for today, which is not in John's Gospel, because this is a special feast day, but is in St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 1, and starting at verse 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came to her and said, "Greetings, O favor one, the Lord is with you." But Mary was greatly troubled at the saying, and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." And Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For with God nothing will be impossible." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. It's a lesson of intense beauty, and the vision that we have has been illustrated so many times by artists. But the words too have been illustrated so many times by musicians. And it's interesting to think that we are not in John's Gospel, where we have been walking profitably through these weeks, and we'll continue with that tomorrow morning. But for today, we're back with our friend St. Luke, who accompanied us really through months of our first months of the Garden Congregation, as we went on that summer 2 years ago, all through Luke and right through Acts, his volume 2. So today we're back with Luke. And notice how very different Luke is, though the same message is there. This is a story being acted out on two different levels, earth and heaven. Recognize that from John. Jesus is trying to get people to realize that all the time in John. Well, Luke does it in a different way for us. Luke is full of music and pictures and the way in which heaven enters people's lives in these first two chapters of St. Luke's Gospel is by the presence of angels and archangels. And there's no, shall we say, coincidence that we call on that presence when we are celebrating the sacraments of the new covenant, breaking bread and saying, therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, holy, holy, holy. And we're back with the angels of Isaiah as he stands in the temple and receives his vocation. Well, here this morning is Mary receiving her vocation as given us in this picture, this beautiful picture of St. Luke. And the most important thing about those two chapters of St. Luke's Gospel, which to me are amongst the most beautiful chapters of the whole of Holy Scripture, the most striking thing is that these are people, young and old, who are faithful to the old covenant, but in that faithfulness and in the way that in their human lives they are being faithful to that old covenant, they are given a completely and radical new beginning. And that is announced to the puzzled members who receive the announcements by the presence of angels. Really, it's difficult to read that, shall we call it again, a pericope. People have asked what the word means. It means a section which stands all by itself as a picture in the Gospels. And we saw in the message on Tuesday, which I'm sorry was taken down for a while, but it's back there now, of how a pericope, that was a different story of the woman who was brought before the public gaze shamefully. And that little story stood by itself. So this story stands by itself as we read it. And of course, we're so used to hearing it read as part of the nine lessons and carols at Christmas time, and no better time to read it. The announcement of the incarnation of our Lord in our own humanity, showing us the gifts, dimensions, and qualities of the kingdom of heaven lived out in a human life, which we ourselves, by the gifts of the Spirit, the overshadowing of the same Spirit that overshadowed Mary, we ourselves can live out those qualities in our daily life. And that faithfulness of the old to the old covenant actually means that this section fits really like a perfect jigsaw piece into chapters 1 and 2 of St. Luke's Gospel. But you've really got to know what's happened in chapter 1 as it goes through. And here we are on the 26th verse of chapter 1 when I began reading. You have to know what's gone on before to know what in the 6 months means. It's in the 6 months, we're told a bit later on in that story, of Elizabeth's pregnancy. And this too was a wondrous thing, which Zechariah in the temple about his duties according to the old covenant, priest of the old covenant, Zechariah couldn't believe. And for a while, you remember, Gabriel's message to him is, as a sign of your disbelief, you will be mute and unable to speak until the baby is born. And then that story goes on. And in the 6 month then gives us the beginning of this story. And here is someone quite different, not of the age of Zechariah and Elizabeth, the old people who thought they were coming to the end of their time in the rhythms of the old covenant and suddenly were given a radical new message of the fact that they would have a child and he would be the herald of the coming of the Anointed One. So that the beginning of the story of John the Baptist, as Luke sets it out, is a preface to the story that we read this morning. And here is a young woman, Mary, all unexpectedly, in the middle of her whatever her daily duties were, at home. She was already espoused to a man named Joseph. And here we have the angel coming and giving her the news of her vocation. And so here are the two levels, angels and archangels, as they will with the shepherds, signifying the heavenly entering into our dimension. That's how Luke portrays it. In John's Gospel, it's done differently, as we've seen day by day. And it's done here to a quartet of the most unlikely people, the inexperienced young and the old, who feel that their active life is almost over and they're being still faithful to the law of God as they've received it. But this morning, the angel greets the startled young Mary with those words which have become absolutely well known across the life of every branch of the Christian Church. In Latin, Ave Maria, and in English, traditionally, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus, adding Elizabeth's words later. But all of this is given almost a musical connotation, because Luke is full of music in these two chapters, as we've said before. And here we are with that startling message. It's a message that will turn Mary's life upside down and Joseph's life upside down. And yet, Mary recognizes in this the will of God for her. And her purity of intention as the handmaid of the Lord, traditionally the words were rendered, "Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word." It's an answer that all of us long by grace to give to God's will for us. And the purity of that intention is signified for us this morning by the blossoming white in profusion of the magnolia, almost rejoicing in this perfect day of sunshine and blue sky for the Feast of the Annunciation. Faithful response. And then the angel left her. And that signifies in Luke's Gospel a return to this plane for all that radical intention of a new covenant now has to be lived out in earthly terms, in Mary's life, in Joseph's acceptance of this as well, and then of the road which followed. Notice already that quality of pondering things in her heart is represented by this passage. The angel's message is given, and then we read, Mary pondered in her heart what sort of message this might be. There is the spiritual reflection. There is the capacity to enter, not mentally, but spiritually, into the other dimension. And yet that will be lived out in decisions made and in her own physicality, with the bearing of a son who will carry out this wondrous message and vocation which the angel has begun with her and then says will be effected in the birth of the son. She has to make some human decisions. And because we're not going on with this lesson tomorrow, because this feast stands alone at this time of year, remember that the decision she makes is to go and visit her cousin Elizabeth and share the news, and find companionship, and find understanding. And so that means, first, an intention of a physical journey, a mental journey and a spiritual journey is already teeming inside her brain and her reflective heart of spirituality. But at the same time, she's going on a physical journey, for if news is surprising news and essentially glorious news, then one must have someone to share it with. And as the angel has mentioned, her cousin Elizabeth, who had thought herself unable in her old age to bear a child, the startling news that she too is now in her 6th month of pregnancy, Mary wants to make a journey, and she does. And if you read both those chapters of St. Luke's Gospel, and they're beautiful things to read on the Feast of the Annunciation, then you will find them full of music and song, but also of characters who were faithful to the old covenant, but now seeking to embrace the radical dimensions of a new covenant which will embrace the whole world. And some of those songs mention that. We come across in Luke chapter 2 the sense of a light to lighten the Gentiles, the peoples of the earth. So all these are being given as signs to us by Luke, and they are angelic signs and musical signs in a way that John gives us reflective signs in the words of Jesus himself. So let's think of a particular date today as we say our prayers, because it is a lovely date. It's a year's mind, the 25th of March, and it's the year's mind of Claude Debussy, the composer, who died on this day in 1918. He died of a stomach cancer, they'd tried to treat, but the treatment was ineffective. We'll come back to that in our reflection in a moment. He'd been born in 1862, and 1862 was born in Paris. Well, born in Saint-Germain-en-Laye, just outside Paris, but his parents moved back into Paris. And so 1862, by the time the child was eight, Paris was under siege, France having lost the Franco-Prussian War, and the armies of Prussia surrounding Paris for the siege. And his parents, before that happened, escaped to Caen in the south of France. And there, the eight-year-old Debussy, in those 2 years there, began to learn the piano. And by the age of 10, he was so proficient at the piano, he came back and went into the Paris Conservatoire, age 10. We're told he was a fine pianist, an outstanding sight reader, but intermittently diligent in his studies. Well, I can relate to that as far as sight reading is concerned, because I myself am able to sight read quite quickly, but it comes with it the temptation to think, oh, I can sight read that, I don't need actually to practice this very hard. And you break away from the kind of constant effort of study. But Debussy did it also because he seems to have been a free spirit right from the beginning. And when he began to write music, he failed to follow orthodox rules of composition. Well, I can relate to that too, with my poor long-suffering music master, Mr. Eric Hilton, who constantly was trying to make me write songs according to the rules of how one should write songs. And I wanted to write songs that were in my head already, and that I tried out harmonies on the piano, and kept getting completely scolded for that, and said, you know, you won't pass any exams this way. And yet, in a way, my playing was for pleasure, and I relate hugely to Debussy in this way. Debussy said at that stage, I'm enamored of my freedom. So after that, he came back to Paris. Now I'm talking 1887 now, so that would make him 25. And he began to, he went to see Wagner's opera, Tristan and Isolde. And while he had no time for the traditional composers of the 19th century, he thought that the Wagner was something that he did love. But he actually said of Wagner in the end, Wagner was a beautiful sunset that was mistaken for a dawn, because he wanted to have a new and radical beginning. And this is where it all starts. In 1894, he wrote something which really appealed to his own heart, an orchestral piece called Prelude à l'après-midi d'un faune. Well, you will know that. And that piece just took the world by storm, as did eventually his opera Pelléas et Mélisande. So that was produced in 1902. And Debussy at that point began to be famous. In 1905, he wrote the orchestral piece La Mer, the sea. And in that, we get the same kind of quality of trying to express his love of nature, which come really in just a few notes. There's always a copy of the preludes of Debussy on the piano in the drawing room here, and of his arabesques, because in a strange way, Debussy's music in one or two notes conjures up the most amazing things. And as we do this, hi Tiger, good morning, how are you? As we do this, then we think, as we listen to Debussy's music or play Debussy's music, an atmosphere is instantly conjured. And how he did that, I don't know, but one critic said he was the lover of vague outlines, of half-lights, of mysterious consonances and dissonances of colour, the apostle of languor, the exclusivist in thought and in style. He refused to be called an impressionist composer, though we'll go back to that in a bit. But what he did do was say in a 1911 interview, "I have made mysterious nature my religion. When I gaze at a sunset sky and spend hours contemplating its marvelous ever-changing beauty, an extraordinary emotion overwhelms me. Nature in all its vastness is truthfully reflected in my sincere, though feeble, soul. Around me are the trees, stretching up their branches to the skies, the perfumed flowers gladdening the meadow, the gentle grass carpeted earth, and my hands unconsciously assume an attitude of adoration." We must agree that the beauty of a work of art will always remain a mystery. Well, I thought this morning, because the first of the second set of preludes is called Brouillard, mists or fogs, and the sight of the sun rising through that mist this morning was pure Debussy. And as I've said, we tend to play Debussy's music on the piano to express a mood. Probably our favorite is the first arabesque to play. But we also put Debussy and with accompanied it with impressionist paintings on a sequence online in our kitchen on a Saturday morning when things are more relaxed. And Debussy helps that mood. And one thinks, as all that plays out, well, of course it's impressionistic. It's very like the painting of Monet, the father of all impressionism, and even more like Giverny, Monet's beautiful garden. And there's music in all of this as well. Monet did it in art. Debussy did it in music. And that music increased as he went on. We were talking this morning and Fletcher said, "My uncle Peter died of cancer far too soon, at the age of 36. And as that was advancing, he was motoring with, as a passenger, with Fletcher's auntie Anne. She was driving and was obviously very concerned about his condition and saw that he was sitting beside her as though sleeping. And when his eyes opened, he said, "What music were you playing? It was really beautiful, full of lovely trumpets and instruments and sounds and harps and wonderful things. What were you playing on the car radio?" And she said, "I wasn't playing anything." And that is something of a story which Fletcher and his Aunt Anne actually treasure, because somehow it caused Uncle Peter at that time to have a sense of, should we say, spiritual repose. And he died not too long after. But Debussy, in the same way as his cancer advanced, still was giving beautiful music. And one thinks of music like Clair de Lune, and the way in which his very personal style, and remembering the prelude à l'après-midi d'un faune, completely original in idea, absolutely personal in style, logical and coherent from first to last, without superfluous bar or even a superfluous note. That was the impression and judgment of one critic. And Pierre Boulez said, modern music was awakened by prelude à l'après-midi d'un faune. And it was as though Debussy, having received from all the gifts of the creator and their beauty, his hands then went to a position of adoration and music, sometimes only in a few notes. And as you play them, that beauty of the creator's gifts causes you to stretch well beyond in heart and imagination. And I so give thanks for that, because just in a few piano notes, something can be conjured. La fille cheveux de lin, or even La cathédrale engloutie, the submerged cathedral, which I spoke about when we were talking about Hugh Walpole's novel, The Cathedral, and he put that musical quotation from Debussy at the beginning of that novel. Debussy rejected labels because they constricted him, but his impressionism in even trying to describe that one of his preludes tries to describe not only reflections in the water, but the sounds and perfumes which are in the sky, the air of the evening. And we ourselves get that every evening as we walk out of the French windows. And the amazingly powerful scent of the Clematis amandii, which is a night-scented flower, just floods around us, awakening all kinds of memories within us. And Debussy's music does that too. And that mixing of art and music and the mystery, which is utterly unfathomable in words, but sometimes art and music and other creative gifts can release. All of that comes with this sense of annunciation, as Mary, without mental understanding and not quite knowing yet physically what she must do, embraces through faith a vocation which opens up the new covenant. Modern music was awakened by prelude à l'après-midi d'un faune, said Pierre Boulez of Debussy, and the new covenant was awakened by that act of faith. Behold the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. Who can wonder that the church has sung Ave Maria in so many different languages, in so many different ways ever since, because here is the pattern of perfect obedience to the Lord's will. And we pray for grace to effect it in our own lives. So let's say our prayers on this beautiful morning and a morning of this beautiful feast, a feast of so much inspiration. We're praying this morning for the church throughout the world and all churches dedicated to the Blessed Virgin Mary. In the course of our Anglican Communion prayers, we're praying for the Diocese of Kivu in the Église Anglicane de Rwanda, a French-speaking province of the Church, and praying for Archbishop Justin, for Bishop Rose of Dover, for Bishop Emma at Lambeth, and for all the parishes of our diocese that are dedicated to the Blessed Virgin Mary. So, here is the prayer for today, not Lenten at all today, but the collect of the Annunciation. We beseech you, O Lord, pour your grace into our hearts, that as we have known the incarnation of your Son, Jesus Christ, by the message of an angel, so by his cross and passion we may be brought to the glory of his resurrection, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So bringing your own intentions and your own concerns, we say together the prayer our Saviour taught us to pray, in obedient response to his grace to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. So, a moment of reflection now on this beautiful day with so many things to think about. This has probably been the best day for sitting here to reflect in the year so far, because it's mild and we have a perfect blue sky. Shall we call it Marian blue this morning? And the sunshine is on this canopy of magnolia, which in its early time of flowering, which this is fully scented. And as it gets towards evening, not only the Clematis amandii begin to scent in the way that Debussy was trying to give us even the scent in his music, and probably that is something that can happen, but when the evening starts, each magnolia, early in its flowering period, gives us a lovely, lovely fragrance. And this is a fragrant feast today, refreshing our Lenten journey as we go forward into Passiontide. Christ give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourself, take up your cross daily and follow him, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, upon those whom you love, and upon those whom you would pray for, now and always. Amen. So have a beautiful day. And once again, we rejoice in our birthday as a garden congregation. We are rejoicing also in Tiger's company. You're well out of your greenhouse area, and yet you've been brave this morning to come and share our birthday.